Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Inna alhamdulillah nahmaduhu wa nasta'inuhu wa nastaghfiruhu wa na'udhu billahi min shururi anfusina wa min sayyiati a'malina man yahdihillahu fala mudilla lah wa man yudlil fala hadiya lah wa ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wahdahu la sharika lah wa ashhadu anna muhammadan 'abduhu wa rasuluhu. أوصيكم ونفسي بتقوى الله أما بعد فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار. We start by praising and thanking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as all praise and all thanks are due to Him. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to help us, and we seek Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's forgiveness. We know that whoever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guides, then none can misguide them. But whoever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala leaves them to go astray, then none also can guide them. And we bear witness that there is nothing and no one that's worthy of being worshipped except Allah, and that Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is his last and his final messenger. And I bear witness that there's no one, we just mentioned that. And the Prophet ﷺ would always remind at the beginning of any speech that the best and the most truthful of words are the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Quran. And the best guidance, the best example is that of Prophet Muhammad ﷺ. The worst of affairs in this religion, in this way of life, are those things which people have added or innovated in acts of worship. So all of those are actually forms of misguidance which lead to the hellfire. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us from it. We continue on in our series. We are going through the fundamentals of Tawheed by Dr. Bilal Phillips. This is talking about the core of any religion, which is the concept of God. So Tawheed is the Arabic word that we usually use to talk about monotheism. Islam has a strict form of monotheism. There are different religions that claim they are monotheistic religions, but we would argue otherwise. So Islam has clearly defined for us in the Quran and the Sunnah of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam what it means to truly believe that there is only one God and how you manifest that through your actions. And we mentioned that because of our lack of knowledge at times, we may find that we do commit some acts which in fact are shirk, which in fact can go against this fundamental concept and this fundamental belief in Islam. So this is why we have dedicated an entire series talking about it. It's the most important type of knowledge, the knowledge about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala himself. So far we have gone through and talked about the various types of tawheed. So the scholars broke it down into different categories so that people could better understand it and to ensure that they didn't limit Tawheed. So many will understand that there is only one creator and that creator is the provider and sustainer, but then they would not only dedicate their acts of worship to him. They would in fact have intermediaries between them and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or they would attribute some qualities that are only due to Allah by using some of these techniques that we have talked about so far. So last week we talked about the issue of omens and charms. So we find that many people will put stock, depending on their maybe culture or nationality, in various actions, in various objects or items, in various expressions that they believe will somehow bring about good luck or prevent bad things from happening to them, and so on and so forth. We said that this is in fact a manifestation of shirk, because a person is then attributing what only belongs to Allah to something which is a very insignificant object in many cases. So now we move on. We are on chapter 5 and we are talking about fortune telling. And I think today I will try to go through chapter 5 and 6. 6 is talking about astrology. So this is something that may take many different names or different manifestations, but we should be aware, yeah? Whether you're going to a bomo or someone who's calling themselves an Ustaz, yeah? But they are using some of these techniques which are unacceptable, then in fact what they are doing is haram, even if they wear a hat and they have a beard and all of those kind of things, yeah? So we're on page 74 in the edition that I have. Is that the appropriate chapter, brother? Yeah. Okay, as was stated in the previous chapter, there are among mankind people who claim knowledge of the unseen and the future. They are known by various names. Among them, fortune teller, soothsayer, foreseer, augur, magician, prognosticator, oracle, astrologer, palmist, etc. Yeah, so there are many different names. We will talk about all of these within this chapter. There's another separate chapter that's dedicated to magic, sihr. Yeah, and this is something also that unfortunately is very common, and it's quite famous in the Muslim world that this region of the world is an area which is very well known for that as well. So we should be aware of that and ensure that we're avoiding it. Fortune tellers use various methods and mediums from which they claim to extract their information. Among them, reading tea leaves, drawing lines, writing numbers, palm reading, casting horoscopes, crystal ball gazing, rattling bones, throwing sticks, yeah, reading cards, whatever it might be. So the person who does this doesn't necessarily have to be some kind of professional that tells you they can do so much and you pay them and all that. It might be sometimes a grandmother in a family. And she says, we flip the coffee cup and then we look at the coffee grounds and then we tell you, yeah, you have good luck coming in your future and so on. This is haram. This is exactly the thing that we're talking about now. So we may find that this becomes a common practice in some of our families. And when a certain person is right once or twice, then we start to say, yeah, it looks like maybe they do have some special connection, yeah, with the unseen world. Or even you will begin to attribute it that this information came to them from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, came to them from the righteous saints or prophets or whatever it might be. All of this is nonsense. And all of this is something forbidden. This chapter will deal with the various fortune-telling arts with the exception of magic. Practitioners of occult arts which claim to reveal the unseen and predict the future can be divided into two main categories. So there's one category which is totally fake, bogus. Whatever they tell you is just nonsense. Some people are good at reading others. Yeah? So when they deal with somebody, they talk to them a bit, they can start to detect this person has some problems. These problems are probably caused by this. Yeah? So they begin to give you some kind of information and you feel, man, it's like this guy knows me. Yeah? So even somebody like myself or Sheikh Hussein, when we start to deal with people a lot in counseling and problems, you start to get a feel. So as you're talking with them, you may tell them something and then they feel, wow, this person has a special connection with me. Why? Because they are telling me about something that I'm going through. We are saying it, why? Because we're all humans and humans have many things in common. So as we begin to discuss with somebody, we can tell, yeah, you're having a problem at home with your wife, you're having some issues with the children, you're having some issues at work and so on. So this person feels as if you can see into their soul. No, it's not like that. It's just an issue of having some experience in dealing with people, some understanding of human psychology. So these kind of people will give many predictions and some of them might come true. And what happens is the person begins to only remember the ones that came true. They forget about all the other things that the person said. And they will use very general things. Someone close to you will pass away in the future. Okay, that's going to happen to everybody. What are you talking about? And then what? And you have gone through some hard times in your life before. Oh yeah, really? Okay, and then what? That happens to everybody. So they will use very general words, but the person, because of their hoping for insight into the future, how to find a solution to a problem, how to avoid something bad, they're grasping at straws. So Dr. Bilal, he gives a statistic here. This book, I think, was originally written in the 80s. So he says, in the year 1980, you know, at the beginning of the year in the West, they will go to some of these so-called famous fortune tellers and so on, and they will publish their predictions for the year. What did they say is going to happen in the world? And they will throw out major things, you know. There will be a war, and there will be this, and there will be that, and whatever it might be. So he said, when they looked closely at the accuracy of their predictions, they were only 24% accurate. Yeah? But many times we don't notice that. As I said, we would grab onto the thing which seemed to be correct. So this is one category that's out there. What they are doing is just trickery and nonsense. The second category are a group that may bring some actual information, detailed facts. But the way they do that is they work and deal with the jinn, Yeah, they work and deal with the world of the jinn. So let's talk a little bit about the world of the jinn. Now obviously, if a person is working with jinn, they don't serve people. Yeah, they make people serve them. So if a person says, I'm a big magician and I can influence jinn and I can cause jinn to do this and to do that, those jinn have already enslaved that person. That's the only way that the jinn will work for that person actually. So that person has to commit shirk, sometimes by worshipping the jinn directly, or worshipping idols and committing other sacrilegious acts. So they will tell them, bring the mushaf, throw it on the ground, step on it, put it in the toilet, write verses of Quran with blood, do this, do that, all kinds of things to show that they have disbelieved in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in the words of Allah, and they have to show their full obedience. Yeah. So in actuality, the scholars have said it's forbidden for true believers to communicate with the jinn, to try to control the jinn in any way or have them do anything for them. The only time that communication might occur is if somebody is trying to cure someone from possession. So when you're reading on the person, the jinn many times will speak, and the person will speak with them and maybe advise them or threaten them and tell them to leave and so on. So there may be some form of communication there. But other than that, it's not allowed for believers to try to communicate with them or to try to control them or ask them to do things for them in any way. Let's talk a little bit about the world of jinn. Some people have attempted to deny the reality of the jinn, about whom the Quran has devoted a whole chapter, Surah Al-Jinn. There's an entire chapter named Al-Jinn, Surah number 72, which talks about some jinn that listened to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and interacted with him. So we have people in modern times who said jinn is negative feelings and subconscious that people have. Jinn are bacteria and viruses. Jinn are this and are that. So people try to come with some rationalization, not willing to accept that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created these creatures. And this is something silly. We live in a world where every day we're discovering new species. Yeah? We live in a world where we know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created humans and millions of different types of animals and plants and microscopic organisms that we cannot even see. It's not difficult for us to accept that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has also created jinn, and that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has also created angels, and so on and so forth. Yeah, and we can obviously have a strong evidence for their existence from the type of influence and effect that they can have in this world. So it's clear that they do exist. By relying on the literal meaning of the word jinn, which comes from the verb jannah yajunnu, which means to cover, hide, or conceal. Yeah, this is the linguistic meaning of the word. So jinn obviously are a creature which are concealed to us. We don't see them, but they can see us. Yeah, and this is not something difficult to accept. We know that there are all kinds of different wavelengths out there that we cannot hear or see. Ultraviolet light, sounds, and you can even know that amongst creatures, there are creatures that can hear things we don't hear. So if you blow a dog whistle, the dog will start barking because it's so loud for the dog. And you don't hear anything at all, subhanAllah. Yeah? And animals can see things which we cannot see. This is why the Prophet ﷺ would tell us, if a rooster crows, he sees angels, malaika. Yeah? So they have the ability, they can see them. If a dog barks, he's seeing jinn, yeah, and shayateen. So these creatures have the ability to see them. Just because we don't see them doesn't mean they don't exist. So they claim that the word jinn really refers to clever foreigners. Yeah? Others have even stated that a jinn is a human who does not have a true mind, but has a very fiery nature. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said he created jinn from fire. So people said, well, let's interpret that figuratively and say it means someone with a hot temper. So this one is what the jinn is. Yeah, this is nonsense. And this is not the way that the Prophet ﷺ understood it, or this is not the way that the Sahaba understood it. The reality is that the jinn represent another creation of Allah which coexists with man on the earth. Now many scholars believe that jinn existed before human beings did. And this is why when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said to the angels, I'm going to create human beings, and send them to the earth. The angels, what did they say? They said, will you create creatures that will shed blood and cause mischief on earth? How did they know that? Angels, they have limited information actually. Yes. No, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was speaking to the angels. Is that what I said, or did I say something different? Yeah. Yeah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was speaking to the angels about human beings. When the angels responded, the scholars said, why did the angels respond? Angels, they don't know the future, but they do know the past. So based on the past, what they had seen the jinn do, they had a feeling that humans may be like the jinn. Why? Because jinn, they have what? What do jinn have that's similar to humans? Free will. They have free will. Animals, they just follow their instincts. Angels, they only obey Allah's command. But the angels have seen what jinn that had free will have done on earth. They caused mischief. They caused problems. Some believed, some disbelieved. There was bloodshed between them. So they were worried, the humans that you will send, they probably will end up doing the same thing. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, I know what you don't know. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows the future actually. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has wisdom behind everything that He does. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created mankind. Now some scholars have said that the way Adam alayhi salam was to mankind, Iblis, the one we call him Iblis, yeah, Lucifer, the head shaitan or devil, was like Adam alayhi salam for the jinn, the first jinn that was ever created. Now we're going to talk a little bit about Iblis here, yeah? But Allah created the jinn before He created mankind, and He also used a different set of elements than those used for man. Allah said, verily we created man from dried clay, from black putrid mud, and we created the jinn before that from a fiery wind. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala described the material He created Adam alayhi salam from in different ways. Sometimes He called it as a dirt, then as a clay. Why? Because it was dirt that was mixed with water that became this kind of like a sticky mud and then dried into a clay. Then Adam alayhi salam was fashioned out of that clay. Now, there are those people who are always trying to be philosophical about everything. And they love to use their own rational thought, and they think that they can properly understand these matters that they never witness with their own eyes. So they said, listen, you're telling me Allah created jinn out of fire. But then we know that in the hereafter, some jinn, they will go to paradise and some will go to hellfire. So how can a jinn be burned by fire when he's created out of fire? Yeah? So the one who asked the sheikh a question, the sheikh took a small chunk of hard dirt and he hit him with it. Boom. And he said, ah, why did you hit me? He said, but you're created from clay. Why did it hurt you? Yeah? So the idea is, don't try to apply your rational thought in these matters. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created them originally from fire. Doesn't mean that they are like fire today. We don't know exactly what they look like or how they exist. And they can manifest themselves in different ways, which we will talk about shortly. So similarly, as Adam alayhi salam was created from clay, today you are not clay anymore. You have all the elements of clay in you, but if you pour water on yourself, you don't disintegrate into mud. Yeah? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has changed the nature of how these species reproduce, even though they were created the first time from a certain element. Angels were created from what? From nur, from light. It's also difficult to fathom. What does that mean? Because angels, they have a massive presence. When the Prophet ﷺ saw Jibreel alayhi salam, he covered the entire horizon. He was terrified when he saw him. He's so massive. He has 600 wings. With one wing, he can destroy the whole earth. But if he's made out of light, what does that mean? So this is something that's beyond our knowledge. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, did they even see their own creation? They didn't see it. You didn't even see how you yourself exist and how Adam alayhi salam was created, much less to understand all of the other creatures. They were named jinn because they are hidden from the eyes of mankind. Iblis, Satan, is from the world of the jinn, even though he was among the angels when they were commanded by Allah to prostrate to Adam. Now there are some verses in the Quran that says Allah ordered the angels to prostrate to Adam and Iblis denied. He rejected. He refused. So some said, oh, that means Iblis, he's an angel. And in Christianity, many forms of Christianity say that Iblis, that Lucifer is what? A fallen angel. There is no such thing actually. Yeah? angels, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, لا يعصون الله ما أمرهم ويفعلون ما يؤمرون. They never disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and what He commanded them, and they fulfill His orders completely, exactly. They have no right to disobey Allah even a little bit. Yeah. So there's no such thing as fallen angels. But jinn, they have free will. So Iblis, he was a jinn, although he had reached the ranks where he was with these angels that are close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and worshipping them. He was given the name Iblis. Why? It comes from the meaning of the word ablasa. Ablasa is to despair. To despair, to give up hope. Yeah. Why? Because he's been cast out and he's been accursed due to his rejection and disobedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Even though he was among the angels, when he refused to prostrate and was asked why did he refuse? Because he was a racist. Yeah? Because he was a racist, actually. And this is a big problem that we have in our world today. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, He said, I am better than him. You created me from fire and you created him from clay. So again, this is the problem that Shaitan had, and it's the problem that many humans have. They come up with their own form of logic. I call it Shaitanic logic. Yeah? So the person starts using their own rational thought to try to make comparisons about what's good and bad, what's better and what's worse. No, that's not how it works. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala defines what's good and what's bad, what's right and what's wrong, not you and using your own logic. So Shaitan, he said, oh, I'm fire. Fire is better than dirt, so I must be better. How come I should bow to him out of respect and prostrate to him when he's made of something that's lesser than me? That's not how it works. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is defining and Allah is commanding, and you fulfill his command. You cannot come and try to use your own argument. But we have people that talk like this. Wallahi, I heard things. It's amazing, shocking. How come Allah gave those people the money? What? That race and that nation, they don't deserve the money that Allah gave them. What? Who are you to decide what Allah should give and not give to people? And how can you define that based on this nationality or based on this race that you are then better? That means zero in the eyes of Allah. Zero. Nothing. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as the Prophet ﷺ said, will only look at your hearts. What are your intentions? And the deeds, your actions, what did you really do? But the color of your skin, the language you speak, the color of your passport doesn't mean anything. It means something in this world, unfortunately, and people make a big deal about it, but in the eyes of Allah, it's not important at all. Yeah? So we need to be careful, because Shaitan, the big problem he had was a jealousy and a hatred, and if I can define it, I say it's racism, actually. Yeah. And because of that, then he became arrogant, and he disobeyed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's command. And we see people falling into the same mistake. Aisha radiallahu anha reported that the Prophet ﷺ said the angels were created from light and the jinn from smokeless fire. Allah also said, and when we told the angels to prostrate to Adam, they all prostrated except Iblis. He was of the jinn. See, it's very important when we make tafsir. The first kind of tafsir we do is we make tafsir of Quran using what? Using Quran. We make tafsir of Quran using Quran. So those that made the argument that said, Allah said he ordered the angels to bow and then Iblis rejected, means Iblis is an angel. We said, no, excuse me, you cannot read one verse by itself, read the whole Quran and then explain. So here's another clear verse where Allah says, Iblis is the only one that rejected and he was of the jinn, finished. That defines the whole issue for you. So we always take a specific verse and use it to define and explain a general verse. This is a rule in tafsir. This is why you and me have to be very careful when we're reading. We don't just come to one verse and say, I got it. Look what Islam says. No. There are other verses on the topic. There are sayings of Prophet Muhammad SAW on the topic. There are the interpretations of the Sahaba that lived these verses that can explain it better. So you cannot jump to conclusions when you're reading the words of Allah until you have the full picture. Therefore, it is incorrect to consider him a fallen angel or the like. The jinn may first be divided into three broad categories in relation to their existence. The Prophet ﷺ said, there are three types of jinn. One type which flies in the air all the time. Yeah. Another type which exists as snakes and dogs. And an earthbound type which resides in one place or wanders about. So the Prophet ﷺ informed us about these categories. There's a category that flies, and people have seen with their own eyes. I don't know if you have it in Malaysia, but it exists in the Middle East. You will come to some place, they will say, we are this traveling band of religious Sufis. Yeah? And they will do chanting and say, we say salawat on the Prophet ﷺ, and we do, and we do. And then when we get in a frenzy, maybe one of them will start to fly. Yeah? And they will say, look, 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 he's so close to Allah. Look at the powers and the karamat and miracles he can do. If somebody does that, he's automatically using jinn. Yeah? Automatically. And we have brothers that have tried. They walk into a gathering like that, they read Ayatul Kursi, the guy falls. Yeah? And there were some, because what they will do, they will stab with swords. Even brothers, my own sheikh told me this one, they bring an AK-47 and they start shooting the guy. Bop, 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 bop. Nothing. No blood, no holes, nothing. Yeah? So the sheikh said his younger brother came, he read Ayatul Kursi, and the one who was using the sword started bleeding immediately. Because they will just have the jinn basically possess them temporarily, and the jinn have their own strengths and abilities physically that they're able to deflect these kind of things or protect themselves and so on. So they prevent it. But the jinn at the same time, even though they have physical strength, they're very weak. Yeah? So we shouldn't get terrified. Sometimes after we talk about these topics, then people get a bit nervous, they can't sleep at night and things like that. Yeah? But Allah gave us very simple ways to protect ourselves. Imagine how weak is the shaitan. The Prophet ﷺ said, when he hears adhan, he has to run away. He cannot take the sound. And he actually makes a sound like he's passing wind to try to cover up the sound of adhan so he doesn't have to hear it. Imagine how humiliating this image is. Yeah, he's running away farting, trying to cover the sound because he doesn't want to hear the adhan. This is how weak he is. Yeah. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, if you say, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam informed us, you say, A'udhu billahi min shaytan rajim, immediately shaytan has to withdraw. Yeah? When he sees you make sujood, what does he do? What does shaytan do when he sees a human make sujood? He cries. He cries like a baby. Yeah? Why? Because he says, I rejected and refused to do it, and here the son of Adam is accepting. Yeah, and it causes him a great jealousy and envy and anger. Yeah, and he begins to cry because he knows he's doomed for not doing that, but you will be saved because you did. You bowed and you prostrated when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded you to do so. If you read Ayatul Kursi before you sleep, the entire night you are safe and protected from jinn. If you make the adhkar when you wake up in the morning, if you make the adhkar after salah, if you make the basic adhkar in the evening or before you sleep, all of this is protection. So the jinn cannot harm the people. Yeah, that's why we call the small book that has all the adhkar, what do we call it? We call it Husn al-Muslim. What does it mean? Fortification or fortress of a Muslim, because it literally protects you and fortifies you, especially from the world of the jinn. So even one of my sheikhs, his friend was possessed while they were walking together in the desert. So when he was trying to clear him from possession and speaking to the jinn, he said, why did you afflict him and not me? He said, we wish we could afflict you, but we couldn't. You were protected. Yeah. So he had made his adhkar and so on, and the angels will protect that person. So this is an important world to understand. Why? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, he's your enemy, so take him as an enemy. So understand his weaknesses and his strengths. Know the weapons and the defense that you have against him. And also, this should make you more God-conscious and closer to Allah. Why? Because you know there is this element that's actually harmful that you cannot see, and you need Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's protection from it. Yeah. There is a category which are snakes and dogs. Let's talk about that for a minute. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's companion was coming home, and he found his wife outside, and she wasn't covered properly, and he was outraged. So he came rushing. So she said, just calm down and look what's inside the house. And there was a huge snake. So he took his spear and he killed the snake immediately. So the Sahaba that were watching, they said, we don't know which one died first, him or the snake. Because that snake was a jinn, yeah? And the other jinn retaliated for him killing and they killed him. So the Prophet ﷺ taught us there's actually an etiquette if you find a snake in your house. Yeah, if it's not a poisonous snake. Poisonous snake rule doesn't apply. But a garden snake, kind of basic category, you actually ask it by Allah to leave your house. And there's a specific wording for that. And then you give it 3 days to leave. Yeah, you actually give it 3 days to leave. If it doesn't leave, then you have the right to kill it. Subhanallah. So this is a world that's out there. The Prophet ﷺ said an all-black dog, for example, could be shaitan. because shaitan, they will come in this form of snakes and dogs. So this is something that's, you know, from that world that we don't fully understand, but they can manifest themselves as these creations. Iblis himself even manifested as human being during the Prophet ﷺ's time. He was there in the council where they were trying to decide what to do to the Prophet ﷺ. So some said, we'll arrest him. Some said, we'll exile him from the land. Shaitan was the one who proposed, we will kill him. He said, let's kill him. And he said, here's the way that you can do it. He gave them the strategy. He said, have one from every tribe hit him at the same time. So then when his clan wants to retaliate, they cannot fight against all the tribes at the same time. Because the clans, even though they're not Muslim, they will immediately retaliate for the Prophet ﷺ's blood. Yeah, because he's one of their people. So they had this kind of like gangsterism, you can say. Yeah. So Iblis was the one who brought that idea. We know the famous story, Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu found Shaytan stealing from the treasury. He was stealing from the Muslim treasury and he was put as a guard over it. So he caught him as a human being. And he said, listen, I'm a poor man and I'm stealing for my family. Please let me go. And he felt bad for him. He said, okay, go. Then second night, the Prophet ﷺ asked him, he said, what happened with your friend last night? He said he was a poor man and this. And he said, okay, he will come again. So he caught him the second time. He said, listen, please, this is the last time. I'll never do it again. He said, I'm going to take you to the Prophet ﷺ. So after he had caught him a few times, he said, okay, listen, I will tell you something which will benefit you. Read Ayatul Kursi before you sleep and the shaitan will not harm you or touch you at all. Yeah, the entire night. So he told the Prophet ﷺ about it. The Prophet ﷺ said, he told you the truth even though he's a liar. And that was shaitan that came to steal from you actually. Yeah, so he came in that human form. So this is a little bit about that world. The Prophet ﷺ also mentioned here the earthbound kind that reside in one place or wander about. So the Prophet ﷺ and the scholars have talked about they prefer to live in places which are, for example, dirty. So bathrooms, this is why when we enter the bathroom we say Bismillah, Allahumma inni a'udhu bika min al-khubathi wal-khaba'ith, the male and female jinn actually, the male and female devils. Before you take your clothes off, you're actually supposed to say what? Bismillah, you mention the name of Allah and you can even make this same dua. So the jinn cannot see you when you're naked. Yeah. One reason that jinn will possess a person is sometimes they fall in love actually with people. Yeah. So it can be a kind of love story, unfortunately. Yeah. So the jinn actually falls in love with this person. So you should protect yourself. Before you have sexual relations, you are supposed to make the dua. Bismillah, Allahumma inni a'udhu bika min al-khubuthi wal-khaba'ith. You can say this before you take your clothes off. And then you say, Allahumma jannibna shaytan wa jannib shaytana ma razaqtana. Oh Allah, keep the shaytan completely away from us and keep what you might bless us with from offspring away from shaytan as well. Or keep shaitan away from our offspring. Yeah. So this is important because the Prophet ﷺ said, when you eat, if you don't say Bismillah, shaitan is eating with you. When you enter your house, if you don't say Bismillah, shaitan is living in the house with you. If you have sexual relations and you don't say Bismillah and make this kind of dua, shaitan is having relations with you. Yeah. So shaitan is there, constantly trying to bother human beings, constantly trying to be a part of their life. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to protect us and our families from him and his soldiers. The jinn may be further divided into two categories. The other place where you will find jinn is also in places that are dilapidated buildings, abandoned buildings, places where buildings are falling down. We see a lot of those in Malaysia, unfortunately, actually, where it seems the job wasn't done. The building's falling apart, but they never completely demolished it. So jinn like to live in those places. So if you enter into any of these kind of places, what can you say? أعوذ بكلمات الله التامات من شر ما خلق. Oh Allah, I seek refuge in your complete and perfect words from any evil thing that you have created. Yeah. So this is even protection from the creatures like scorpions and tarantula and whatever it might be, and also from the jinn. So before you enter even a new home that you're moving into or a new office or whatever it is, you should make this kind of dua. You can say it three times. This is also in the small book called Hisn al-Muslim. The scholars also mentioned, for example, when you want to throw garbage or you want to pour hot water in certain places and so on, you should also say Bismillah, mention the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, say A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajim, so that if there are any jinn there, because sometimes you might harm them. Yeah? And then they retaliate because you physically harmed them. So the Prophet ﷺ also taught us there are certain things that we leave for them. So for example, in the desert, in the old times when they use the toilet out in the open, they will clean themselves with water, or if they don't have water, then they will use perhaps leaves, or they will use these kind of smooth stones or something like this to clean themselves with. So the Prophet ﷺ forbid them because the practice of some Arabs was that they would use also dry bones of dead animals that have been sitting out in the desert, or they would use this kind of dry and petrified dung, camel dung or cow dung or this kind of stuff. So the Prophet ﷺ said these kind of things are najis. You can't use them actually to clean yourself with. And at the same time, they are food for the jinn. The jinn eat from those bones and that kind of dung and so on. So there are different species, even the way that they eat and live and so on is different. The jinn may be further divided into two categories in relationship to their faith, those that are Muslims and those that are kafir, those that are disbelievers. Allah refers to the believing jinn in Surah Al-Jinn. So what happened was, the jinn noticed a big difference in the universe. Previously, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had been relaxed with the jinn. So the jinn, they would go up into this first sky and they would eavesdrop on the angels. The angels would be passing the command that comes down from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, from al-lawh al-mahfuz, something that's going to happen today. So-and-so is going to get in a car accident. It's going to rain. It's going to snow. This person is going to slip and fall. This person is going to find some money. This person is going to have this and this. And the angels are the ones that are involved in all of these kind of actions that are going on. So they are passing the command verbally from one to another. So the jinn, they would listen in, and then they would have information about the immediate future, what's going to happen. So then they would also work with their magicians and soothsayers and pass them the information, and then people would magnify those individuals and begin to worship them and say, wow, look, they know about what's going to happen in the future. Or they have very detailed information about the past. Why? Because the jinn are around all the time, so they have the information. So then they pass the information. Yeah, we saw him do this. And once his mother said to him like this before she died. And then his father did this and tell him all these things. And they begin to tell him and he says, oh my God, how could you know this? Nobody knows this. So you must have knowledge of the unseen. Now when the Prophet ﷺ came and the Quran began to be revealed, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala fortified the sky and he changed everything. So he made it very difficult for jinn to get any information from the angels, yeah, to be able to listen to that kind of information. So when the jinn realized something has changed, they said, we're not sure why, let's find out. So they started deploying different, you know, groups of jinn to travel around the earth and find out what great event has happened that Allah has changed everything in the universe. Yeah. So they found Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam with some of the sahaba, with some of the companions, and the Prophet ﷺ was praying and they were reciting Quran out loud. So this group of jinn, they came and they listened, and the Prophet ﷺ wasn't even fully aware of it yet. And then they had a conversation with each other about it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala narrated it to us in this surah. So here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, O Muhammad ﷺ, it has been revealed to me that a group of jinn listened and said, verily we have heard a marvelous Quran. It guides unto righteousness, so we have believed in it, and we will never make partners with our Lord. May our Lord's glory be exalted, has not taken a wife nor a son. What the foolish ones among us used to say about Allah is a horrible lie. Yeah. So we know that the Arabs themselves had superstitions about jinn. So they said the angels are the daughters of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that he had with the jinn. Nonsense. Yeah. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala responded to this, said, Allah doesn't take children, number one. And number two, you attributed to him children that you yourself despise. Because the Arabs, what happened to them? They became a very chauvinist society to the point that they hated girls. So when one of them has a daughter, what would they do? They will even bury her alive. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, amazing. First of all, you attribute to me something which does not befit me. I'm not a creation that I need to have offspring. I'm the creator of all things. Number two, you attribute to me the offspring which you yourself despise. How insulting is that? you don't want to have daughters, then you say Allah has daughters. Very strange kind of logic. So now the jinn, they are talking about this. They are saying, Allah doesn't have wife, doesn't have children, and those foolish people amongst us, and those jinn that used to claim all these kind of things, these are just lies, and they are not true. So they became Muslims. And there are among us Muslims and others who are unjust, meaning those who are disbelieving in Allah. Whoever accepts Islam has sought out the right path. As for those who are unjust, they will be the fuel for the hellfire. So this is what the jinn were actually saying. The disbelievers among the jinn are referred to by various names in both Arabic and English. Ifrit, Shaytan, Qareen. What's a Qareen? The Qareen is the jinn that every single one of you has with you right now. Yeah? A'udhu billahi minash shaytanir rajim. So he's there with you, constantly trying to influence you, constantly trying to encourage you to do something evil. Every single human being that has ever existed has had a qareen with him, even Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And then in English, obviously, demons, devils, spirits, ghosts. Are there ghosts? Which is the soul, for example, of your, you know, grandfather or uncle or whoever that died, that can come back in this world and influence something or talk to you. Does that exist in Islam? No, there's no such thing. The soul of a human being, once it leaves their body in this world, can never influence this world again. Cannot talk to anybody in this world, cannot cause any physical thing to happen in this world. Yeah. So there is a barzakh, as we talked about previously. Yeah, this is an important fundamental concept to understand before getting to this point. Barzakh is a barrier. So once a person dies, there's a barrier between them and this world and the people in this world. They try to misguide man in various ways. Whoever listens to them and becomes a worker for them is referred to as a human shaitan. So shaitan can also apply to human beings. Allah said in the Quran, likewise we have made for every prophet an enemy, shaitans from among mankind and the jinn. So the idea is that whoever serves Iblis and becomes one of his soldiers, then he's automatically called a shaitan, whether he's a human or a jinn. And the reality is that in this battle that's going on in this world, there are no spectators. You got to pick sides. Either you're a soldier of Allah or you're a soldier of shaitan. Either you're an ally of Allah and the believers or you're an ally of shaitan and his soldiers. Yeah, that's the way it works. So it's very important for us to understand that you're in a war. Because when you know you're in a war, then what do? You're alert, you're cautious, you're defensive, you're ready to attack where possible and necessary. But if you think that this life is a game, then you walk around heedlessly. And then brothers and sisters come and say, we got afflicted by jinn, we have this one, we have that one. Ya akhi, you didn't think your enemy will try to hurt you and attack you? Of course he will. But the idea is if you pray, if you make your dhikr, if you do your part with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if you ally yourself with him, then he will protect you, and there's no way that shaitan can defeat Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and his soldiers. Never. Shaitan is a dog of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you tell Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, pull your dog back, he will pull him back, and shaitan is so weak. It's as simple as that. So the idea is shaitan tries to magnify himself to the point that he tries to copy Allah. So shaitan has a throne, the way Allah has a throne. But of course, there's no comparison between shaitan's throne and Allah's throne. Shaitan made his throne over the water, yeah, over the oceans and the seas. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's throne in the very beginning, before he created anything, as the Prophet ﷺ described to us, was above water. His throne was over water. So shaitan is trying to imitate that. And shaitan actually has meetings with his soldiers on a daily basis. So the Prophet ﷺ said, The shayateen, yeah, especially amongst the jinn, they will work all day. They come back to shaitan to report, what did we accomplish today? So one of them will say, listen, I stayed with him, that human being, until I got him to commit such and such sin, or until I got him not to do such and such good deed. Shaitan will be disappointed. He'll say, you didn't do anything. That's worthless. You're proud of what you did? That's nothing. And he will keep listening, till one of them will say, I stayed with him till I caused what? Till I caused divorce, separation between the family. Why? Because family is the unit of society. When families fall apart, then everything falls apart. Look now how the family structure has been destroyed in the West, and look how the society has become so degenerate. Morals, ethics, values are being lost, and people are being going all kinds of crazy directions where you can't even tell who's a human being anymore. What is this? From the way they treat their bodies, from the kind of sexual relations they have, from the things they do. It's disgusting things. And it all starts from lack of a proper family structure. So Shaytan tells that one, you did it, come. And he sits him on his throne next to him to honor him because he did a good job. Yeah. So this is something you need to remind yourself about next time you're what? Arguing with your wife. Yeah. Say, I was bilam Shaytan ajim. Wait a minute. We shouldn't fall into this trap. We know who's there pumping. Yeah. The Prophet ﷺ saw a man who was getting mad and he said, Shaytan is like blowing in him. Trying to get him to pump up, to get angry, yeah? And his blood pressure is rising, till he says or does something that he regrets. Ruins relationships with family and friends and so on forever, yeah? Wal-ayadu billah. Ifrit, shaitan, qareen, devils, okay. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, we read that, every human has an individual jinn accompanying him, referred to as a qareen, a companion. It literally means that. This is part of man's test in this life. The jinn encourage his lower desires and constantly try to divert him from righteousness. They don't rest. Yeah? So you may strive to be righteous, then you get tired and you say, ah, okay, I did it for a while, but I can't do it forever. That's why the Prophet ﷺ said, the thing you do which is continuous, even if it's a little bit, that's better. Better than doing a lot, then you say, oh, I can't do it. Because shaitan, he doesn't get tired. He waits. Yeah? Iblis himself, he has been given by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that he will not die until the day of judgment. So from Adam alayhi salam's time until the end, he's alive. Now other jinn, they also live a long time. My sheikh, for example, was doing an exorcism on someone. That jinn was 400 years old. Yeah, so they live a long time. The reality is that most of us, when we pass away, the qareen will stay alive longer than that. That's why later on a fortune teller can work with that qareen and start giving information about someone who died. And even those jinn can begin to imitate voices. So sometimes the person will say, but I heard the voice of my father and he was talking to me. And he said like this, and he used words with me that only he would use with me. Nobody else could have used it. It's the qareen. The qareen knows you so well, better than your spouse or anyone else. He's with you 24/7. And he doesn't get tired, constantly trying to misguide you, constantly trying to lead you astray. So this is something that we have to always be aware and vigilant of. The Prophet ﷺ referred to this relationship as follows. He says, every one of you has assigned a companion from the jinn. The Sahaba, they asked, even you, O Messenger of Allah ﷺ? And the Prophet ﷺ replied, even me, except that Allah has helped me against him and he has submitted. Now he only tells me to do good. Some scholars said it means the Prophet ﷺ converted him to Islam. He became a Muslim. Others said, no, it means Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protected the Prophet ﷺ from any of his harm or his bad advice and so on. Allah knows best which is the correct interpretation. But this was a unique status for the Prophet ﷺ. So no one else can claim, my qareen giving me good advice. Now the qareen, does he need to come to you and say, hey, go prostrate to that statue there. Hey, go commit zina, go drink alcohol. Nah. He can tell you, Hey, why don't you go and do this good Islamic thing? He might tell you that. Why? Why would he tell you to go and do a good thing? What would his strategy be there? Yeah, this one we can do a whole lecture just about the strategies of shaitan. Why would he come and tell you to go and do something good so you'll miss what? Something better. Yeah, something better. So shaitan has his ways. He cannot come to you, a good practicing Muslim, and say, bow to the statue. You'll say, what? I'm not going to commit shirk. You think I'm crazy? But shaitan, he takes you how? He takes you step by step. So step one will be, leave some good deeds, which are voluntary. They're extra. Don't push yourself too much. Moderation, brother, moderation. Don't be an extremist. Yeah? Shaitan will talk to you like that. Then once you leave those things, he comes to you on obligations. He says, you will do it, but maybe just a little bit late, but risky. You have to make some money. You're busy. You cannot do your prayers always difficult for you. Come on. You have many children. They are depending on you. So shaitan comes like that, yeah? So then he will get you to leave that thing. If he can't get you to leave that thing, he'll try to get you to spend your time or your money on something which is good, but not as good. That's why the scholars said there's a whole science in Islam which is called the fiqh of priorities. Fiqh of prioritizing. How do you prioritize? What's more important? In this 5 minutes, I could do two good things. Which one's better? So I have to know what's better. How can I know that? I need knowledge. Knowledge from Quran and Sunnah about which good deeds are more important, which are better, which bad deeds are worse, which ones are not as bad. So shaitan has his ways. If he can't get you to do a sin, he'll get you to leave a good thing. And he'll try to take you step by step by step by step until you fall into the big things which can lead you to hellfire. May Allah protect us. Prophet Sulaiman alayhi salam was given miraculous control over the jinn as a sign of his prophethood. Allah said, "And we gathered for Sulaiman his army from the jinn, mankind, and the birds, and they were all kept in order and ranks." Sulaiman alayhi salam, he said, "O Allah, give me a kingdom which will not be given to anyone else. It's never been given, never will be given." So Allah answered that dua and gave him an army which even he controlled the wind. He had the jinn, the animal kingdom, the birds, the humans. It was unbelievable. Yeah, under his control, subjugated to him. So even the jinn, when Sulaiman alayhi salam died, they didn't realize he had died. They kept serving him for a long time after. Yeah. Because they thought he was still alive, but they were enslaved to him and he had control over them. So this is something that was given only to him. So the Prophet ﷺ himself had a chance to subjugate some jinn, then he refrained because of the dua of Sulaiman, which this was only given by Allah to him. But this power was not given to anyone else. No one else is allowed to control the jinn and no one can. The Prophet ﷺ said, "Verily an ifrit." Ifrit, they translate it as a strong or a powerful evil jinn. Yeah, from among the jinn, he spat on me last night, trying to break my salah. The Prophet ﷺ is praying, this jinn comes and he spits, and the Prophet ﷺ can see him. In one narration, the Prophet ﷺ said, "I choked him." Yeah, and I was gonna imprison him and tie him to the pillar in the masjid and have the children come and pelt him and let the people see him. But then I remembered the dua of Sulaiman alayhi salam. Here it says, "However, Allah let me overpower him, and I wanted to tie him to one of the columns in the masjid so that you all could see him in the morning. Then I remembered my brother Sulaiman's prayer, 'O my Lord, forgive me and bestow on me a kingdom not allowed to anyone after me.'" Man cannot gain control over the jinn, as this was a special miracle given only to Prophet Sulaiman alayhi salam. So as we mentioned, if jinn serve anyone, the reality is that person is serving the jinn, because nobody can control jinn. There are some stories though that jinn did work for some of the righteous scholars in the past without the scholar asking for that though. Yeah, so they narrated that Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah, jinn would actually come and sweep up his house and clean his house for him, and then they would leave. Yeah, and he never asked for that. They would even write questions to him, and then they would leave like notes there, then he would answer the fatwas for them verbally. Yeah, so there were Muslims from among the jinn, and there are stories even of people that are passing through the desert. They will pray, and as they're praying, they hear ameen behind them. Jinn are praying actually in the rows behind them and saying ameen. There are some stories even from our modern times. Sheikh bin Baz rahimahullah, great scholar, passed away maybe around 1999. He was giving a lecture, and there were people in the room there. He's blind, he cannot see, yeah, rahimahullah. So somebody came in and didn't close the back door. So it was noisy outside or cold or something. So this man in the front, he was very upset. So he reached his arm all the way to the back and he slammed the door shut. So the people that saw it, they got terrified. And then they explained to the sheikh what had happened. So the sheikh said, "I ask you by Allah, are you a jinn?" He said, "Yes." He said, "If you come to my class, you don't ever do such a thing again. You just stay in a normal appearance. Don't do any kind of supernatural things like this. Just remain normal and you can attend the class." And the one who's narrating the story says, "I used to drive him to the class every day and I didn't realize he's like this." Yeah? So he had brought himself in the form of a human being. So these kind of interactions, they do still exist in different ways, subhanAllah. Man cannot gain control over the jinn, as this was a special miracle, as we mentioned. In fact, contact with the jinn in circumstances other than possession or accident is most often made by the performance of sacrilegious acts, meaning you are doing something which is kufr or shirk. Yeah, and they will ask you to insult Allah and the Prophet you know, denigrate the Quran, disrespect the Quran, and so on. These are acts despised and forbidden in the religion. The evil jinn summoned in this fashion may aid their partners in sin and disbelief in God. Their goal is to draw as many others as they can into the gravest of sins, the worship of others besides or along with God. So in reality, the one who deals with the jinn as a magician, that is kufr, and the punishment in Islam is execution. Yeah, it's a death penalty, because they are actually a great cause of fitna and misguiding of other people. So many a person begins to follow these people. Why? Because they see them do some supernatural things. They see them able, for example, somebody comes and says, I'm possessed by jinn. And the other one says, I'll cure you. But he doesn't cure using Quran or the words of Allah. But he has jinn that work for him. Those jinn can get that jinn to leave, overpower him. The jinn are different strengths, different levels, different hierarchy, and so on. That jinn himself who's possessing the person may work for that or work with that magician, so he just has him leave. So that's why you always have to be careful, because we do hear so many stories, and I've heard many even in Malaysia, where people say, oh, we took it to so-and-so and he was able to cure and do this. What was he reciting? Yeah, he was reciting something. No, you need to hear. Is it Quran? Is it Arabic? Or is it gibberish? Because they're maybe calling the jinn themselves through their names and so on. That's why we said when they write on papers, then they roll it and say, don't open it. And the shiukh that come and open it, fine. It's written in strange languages, or it's written in maybe a language that we understand, but then using strange names, calling the names of those jinn, actually. Yeah. So this kind of thing is forbidden. Although it may bring some result, the result is something haram. You have to believe that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one that cures, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one that protects you, not the shaykh or the reciter or whoever it is. And the shaykh themselves who's doing the recitation can only use permissible means, the words of Allah, the dua and supplication taught by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and so on. Yeah. Okay. Once contact and contract with the jinn are made by the fortune teller, the jinn may inform them of certain events in the future. The Prophet ﷺ described how the jinn gather information about the future. He related that the jinn were able to travel to the lower reaches of the heavens and listen in on some of the information about the future, which the angels pass among themselves. They would then return to the earth and feed the information to their human contacts. This used to happen a lot prior to the prophethood of Muhammad ﷺ, and fortune tellers were very accurate in their information. They were able to gain positions in the royal courts and enjoyed much popularity and were even worshipped in some regions of the world. That's why when you read through anthropological studies and history, you find all the cultures and societies, they had these kind of magicians. And they had these kind of people even as advisors directly to the kings, directly to the emperors and the leaders. Why? Because they literally could bring some valuable information. So immediately they were given this kind of prestige, even though they were actually evil people. After the Prophet ﷺ began his mission, the situation changed. Allah had the angels guard the lower reaches of the heavens carefully, and most of the jinn were chased away with meteors and shooting stars. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about how he would use what we call shooting stars, but these are usually the meteors. You can see them sometimes streaking through the sky. These literally became missiles that kill and destroy the jinn. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would send it on them, even if they were able to get some information, and they would be destroyed before they were even able to pass the information down. But the Prophet ﷺ described what they would do. He said, literally, the jinn will stack up. They will stack up, stack up, stack up, till they reach to a certain level where they can hear things. Then they get that information, they pass it down. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would send the angels or the meteor to destroy them, but they may get that information down to the next jinn before they're killed or destroyed. So they would pass that word of truth to the soothsayer, but with 100 lies. So in the past they had a lot of accurate information, now they will bring just a tiny bit of information. something very small. Yeah, and then they'll mix it with a lot of generalities, which we said the fake ones will do. Oh, something bad is going to happen to someone you know in the future. Okay, and then what? Who? Yeah, but they'll bring something specific that might actually occur. Okay, Allah described this phenomenon in the following Quranic statement made by one of the jinn. The jinn, this is in the same surah where they're narrating their situation. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, we the jinn had sought out the heavens but found it filled with strong guardians and meteors. We used to sit on high places in order to listen, but whoever listens now finds a flame waiting for them. Yeah, so they will be destroyed. Allah also said, and we have guarded it, the sky. Yeah, heavens here doesn't mean paradise. So sometimes they translate it as heavens. This is an older English version of sky. Yeah. So the seven skies are not the same as paradise. Paradise, Jannah, is something totally different than samawat. We understand this, inshallah. Yeah. When we see heavens, it doesn't mean heaven as in paradise. It means the skies. And we have guarded it from every cursed devil, except the one who is able to snatch a hearing, and he is pursued by a brightly burning flame, which is the meteor. Ibn Abbas said, when the Prophet ﷺ and a group of his companions set out for the Uqadh market, the devils were blocked from hearing information in the heavens. Meteors were let loose on them, so they returned to their people. When their people asked what happened, they told them, some suggested that something must have happened, meaning in the universe or in the earth. So they spread out over the earth seeking the cause. Some of them came across the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and his companions while they were in salah, and they heard the Quran. They said to themselves that this must have been what blocked them from listening. When they returned to their people, they told them, verily we have heard a marvelous Quran. It guides unto righteousness, so we believed in it, and we will never make partners with our Lord. See, this is an important part of tafsir. Who's Abdullah ibn Abbas? He's a companion of the Prophet ﷺ, and he is actually a great commentator of Quran. The Prophet ﷺ literally put his hand on his chest and said, O Allah, give him the interpretation of the book. Give him the ability to interpret the Quran. So he's one of the great references that we go back to for interpretation of Quran and tafsir. Here, this is what we call asbab al-nuzul. When you interpret a verse, you can look at the linguistic meaning. Yeah, this is one thing. You can interpret and translate the words. But you also need to have an understanding of what's the incident that occurred behind this. These words were revealed in relation to what? What was the story behind it? That's what we call the reason behind the revelation, asbab al-nuzul. Yeah. So here, this is giving us that story. Yeah, Abdullah ibn Abbas is actually the cousin of the Prophet ﷺ and one of the great scholars of Islam. Thus the jinn could no longer gather information about the future. Could no longer gather information about the future as easily as they could before the Prophet ﷺ's mission. Because of that, they now mix their information with many lies. The Prophet ﷺ said they would pass the information back down until it reaches the lips of a magician or a fortune teller. Sometimes a meteor would overtake them before they could pass it on. If they passed it on before being struck, they would add to it 100 lies. Yeah? So meaning the jinn or the fortune teller himself will add 100 lies to bulk up that information, because it's just a very small piece of information. Aisha radiallahu anha reported that when she was asked, when she asked Allah's messenger about fortune tellers, he replied that they were nothing. She then mentioned that the fortune tellers sometimes told them things which were true. The Prophet ﷺ said, that is a bit of truth which the jinn steals and cackles in the ear of his friend, but he mixes along with it 100 lies. And then here's a story about Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu with a man that used to be a fortune teller. The jinn are also able to inform their human contact of the relative future. For example, when someone comes to a fortune teller, the fortune teller's jinn gets information from the man's qareen of what plans he has made prior to his coming. So this is another technique or trick. Brother, can you turn on the fan, if you don't mind? Jazakallah khair. So what will happen is that the qareen, he's with you all the time. So you have plans. You put your plan into your iPhone, you put your plan on the calendar, you tell your spouse or your siblings about your plan, so the qareen knows what the plan is. next week we're going to do this, tomorrow we're going here. So when you come to the fortune teller, he tells you some of this information, and you say, my God, he knows the future. He says, you know, on Thursday you're going to see the doctor, and hopefully everything will be okay, don't worry. Yeah. So you already have a doctor's appointment, you've already scheduled it in your calendar and so on. So this is another technique that the fortune teller also will use. So the fortune teller is able to tell him that he will do this or that or go here or there. By this method, the real fortune teller is able to learn about a stranger's past also in vivid detail. So the qareen can give the fortune teller exactly what you've been doing. Who are your parents? Where were you born? Where are you from? Where did you go to school? And the fortune teller will begin to tell you, and you will say, my God, this is a miracle. How could he know such a thing? To show also their strength and ability, the jinn, they can travel very fast. So when Prophet Sulaiman, he wanted the throne of the Queen of Sheba, Bilqis, yeah, Ifrit from amongst his council from the jinn, said, I will bring you her throne before you stand up from here. Yeah, within moments I'll bring it. From a long distance, yeah, you're talking about a distance that humans at that time would need maybe months to travel by foot or by camel or horse or whatever it might be. So this jinn said, I'll bring the throne here for you within a very short time period. So this is showing their ability. The jinn themselves can also have information about, for example, something which is lost, where is it, things like this. So they'll pass this kind of information on. When the fortune teller tells you, you go and find it, then you're like, oh my goodness, look, it's something miraculous. This person has a special connection. Now we come to the important part, the very end of this chapter, page 84, the Islamic ruling on fortune telling. So what does Islam say about this? The Prophet ﷺ laid down very clear principles. He said, the salah of whoever approaches a fortune teller and asks him about anything will not be accepted for 40 days and nights. This is if you come to a fortune teller and you're just doing it for fun. You don't believe in them. You don't believe they have power over the unseen or the future, or they can really predict what's going on and so on. You know that they are mushrikeen and what they are doing is haram. You still come to them and ask them for 40 days, that's 200 prayers, your prayers will not be accepted by Allah. Do you still have to pray those prayers? Yeah. So salah has two elements to it. Number one, there is a sin for not praying. So when you pray, you remove the sin for not praying. And then when you pray, there is a reward from Allah in accordance with how sincere and how good the prayer was. Yeah? So the scholars here said, you will have the sin removed for not praying, but you will not get any reward at all, zero. Can you imagine? One prayer can make the difference maybe between one level in paradise and the next. You will lose out on 200 prayers if you just go to such a thing. Now, what happens if you believe in them and you go to them really wanting to know about the future and thinking that they can prevent things and help you somehow and so on? The Prophet ﷺ said that this person has disbelieved in what has been revealed to Prophet Muhammad ﷺ. On the next page, the Prophet ﷺ said, whosoever approaches a fortune teller and believes what he says has disbelieved in what was revealed to Muhammad. This person is a kafir. Yeah, is not a Muslim anymore. Let's go back to the previous page. This prohibition is further supported by Muawiyah ibn al-Hakam as-Salami in his hadith, which he said, O Messenger of Allah, verily there are some people among us who visit oracles. The Prophet ﷺ said, do not go to them. Such a severe punishment has been assigned for only visitation because it's the first step to believing in fortune telling. If one went there doubtful about its reality and some of the fortune teller's predictions come true, one will surely become a true devotee of the fortune teller and an ardent believer in fortune telling. So the Prophet ﷺ is preventing us from falling into that major sin where you commit shirk and you're actually taken out of the fold of Islam. Now, why is it a form of shirk? Such a belief assigns to creation some of Allah's attributes with regard to the knowledge of the unseen and the future. Consequently, it destroys Tawheed al-Asma wa Sifat and represents a form of shirk in this aspect of Tawheed. Now you're assigning to this person knowledge of the unseen, which only Allah has. Even Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam himself was told by Allah, you don't know the unseen. You only know whatever Allah has revealed to you and informed you about. Yeah, so this is very important for us to keep in mind. The ruling of kufr includes, by analogy, what's analogy? Qiyas. Qiyas here is, we look at the ruling, we see what is the effective cause of the ruling. Anything that has a similar effective cause has the same ruling. This is called qiyas. For example, cocaine, is it haram? Bring me the hadith. Any hadith that talks about cocaine? So what's your evidence? You are making something haram? You are not Allah, you cannot do that. How come it's haram? How come? Based on qiyas, the Prophet ﷺ talked about intoxicants at that time, such as wine and alcohol and so on. Anything that does the same thing today is also haram, doesn't matter what the name of it is. Yeah, methamphetamines, cocaine, heroin, whatever it might be. Those things that are altering and intoxicating your mind, they are forbidden as well. And especially when those things may cause also death or severe health problems, obviously they can become haram for this reason as well. Yeah. So this is a form of qiyas. So here, Dr. Bilal Phillips says, we also make qiyas that this ruling applies to those things, for example, that we read in books, or the writings of fortune tellers, like the horoscope in the newspaper, yeah? Listening to them on the radio, watching them on TV. In America, we had call-in numbers. They will bring commercials on TV. They say, call this 1-800 number, talk to, gypsy witch so-and-so, and she will tell you about your future and whatever it is, yeah? Now, the one that I heard about here is, people said, oh, I called Ustaz in Indonesia, and then I give him my name and my father's name, and he tells me, you have this and that, and you're possessed by jinn maybe, and you have sihr and that one, and no, you don't have any problem, or who's the one that caused it, and what? What is this? What is this? The guy never even saw you, met you, nothing, and he can tell you all this about yourself? Obviously he's using jinn, and this is something totally haram, forbidden. So we have to be very conscious and aware, and we don't fall for names or the fact that they may have accomplished certain things and claim that they are doing it using Islam and using Allah's name and so on. No, this is something unacceptable. As these are the most common means used by 20th century fortune tellers to spread their predictions. And these things, it's amazing. You go even to Manhattan, where a square inch is so valuable, and you'll find amongst all these skyscrapers in Wall Street, a small little office for a palm reader and a fortune teller. What? And they are making so much money, they can afford the rent there. Why? Because this powerful person is coming and saying, today am I going to have a good deal or not? Should I sell or should I buy? Yeah? And they get some advice sometimes from these kind of witches and so on. Subhanallah. Yeah, may Allah protect us. Allah clearly states in the Quran that no one knows the unseen besides Him, not even the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And why do we mention Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Because if any human will have that honor, he's the best human that ever lived. So if he didn't have it, then nobody who's lesser than him, and everyone is lesser than him, can have such power. With him are the keys to the unseen, meaning with Allah, and none knows it except him alone. Even the angels don't know the unseen. They only know what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells them about. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam also told us, or also was told, this is in the Quran, say, O Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, I have no power to bring good to myself nor avert harm, but it is only as Allah wills. If it were that I knew the unseen, I would have multiplied the good and no evil would have touched me. So the reality is, if somebody really knows the future, then nothing bad should ever happen to them. And only good things should happen to them. And every good thing they ever want should be accomplishable. But see that fortune teller or whoever it is, and they're like every other human. They may get sick and they will die eventually, and some bad thing happens and good things they want don't happen. They have no control over the universe or the future. And he, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, was also told to say, none in the heavens nor the earth knows the unseen except Allah. Now we have Muslims that make claims. The Shia, for example, say their 12 imams know everything about the future and everything that's currently going on. This is bogus, nonsense. We have from the Sufis that also say there is a council of saints that have control and they meet on a weekly basis and they talk about what will happen next week and so on. What is this? Garbage. Yeah? Therefore, all the various methods used around the world by oracles, fortune tellers, and the likes are forbidden to Muslims. Palm reading, I Ching, I don't know what that is that something Chinese? Fortune cookies, tea leaves, as well as zodiacal signs and biorhythm computer programs, all claim to inform those who believe in them about their future. However, Allah has stated in no uncertain terms that He alone knows the future. Allah says, verily the knowledge of the hour is with Allah alone. It is He who sends down the rain and knows the contents of the womb. No one knows what he will earn tomorrow, nor in which land he will die, but Allah is all-knowing and aware. And subhanAllah, even with our modern technology, we don't always predict these kind of things accurately. Why? Because it's truly only Allah's knowledge. I remember when my daughter Huda was in her mother's womb, and the doctor told us, you're going to have a boy. And my mother sent a box of boys' clothes, very excited, first grandchild. Then a month later, the doctor says, you want to know what gender? We said, excuse me, you already told us. She said, what did I say? We said, boy. She said, sorry, wrong. It's a girl. We said, mashallah, great. So even their ultrasound and 3D and color and this, and they got it wrong. Yeah. My wife was telling me just today that 1/5 of women in Canada, they will have a miscarriage. SubhanAllah. Yeah? 1/5 of pregnancies. And can doctors tell with full confidence, this mother, you will have miscarriage or you will have the baby? Never. Only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows. SubhanAllah. So this kind of things that Allah is mentioning here, even very basic things for us as humans, now we say we are very technologically advanced and powerful, still we cannot predict. My wife lived in Calgary in Canada, so the weather, they couldn't predict it for a week. They had to give it to you on an hourly basis. Because there was an area where, subhanAllah, these Chinook winds, this warm wind will come. So one day you are wearing t-shirt in the morning, then you are wearing coat in the afternoon because you are so cold, then it snows, then it rains, it's crazy. And one day you are confused, you don't know what to wear and how to plan. So even the weatherman there, his job is a joke. He cannot predict the future, he doesn't even know what to tell you. So he tells you next hour it should be okay, after that we don't know, good luck. Yeah, he cannot give you a week forecast, subhanAllah. So here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, he's the only one who knows actually, if the rain will come down, what the womb contains, even though we claim that we are so powerful and advanced, still we are too weak. Therefore, Muslims must take utmost care in dealing with books, magazines, newspapers, as well as individuals who in one way or another claim knowledge of the future or the unseen. For example, when a Muslim weatherman predicts rain, snow, or other climatic conditions for tomorrow, he should add the phrase, inshallah. Yeah, if Allah wills, that will happen. Likewise, when the Muslim doctor informs her patient that she will deliver a child in 9 months or on such and such a day, she should take care to add the phrase, inshallah, as such statements are only estimations based on statistical information. It was interesting to know that when they even calculate the date of birth, they do it based on the specific day based on the last menses that the woman had. So the actual day that the baby was conceived, it's not very accurate. Could be off by weeks. And that's why in the West, for example, they will allow to go even a couple weeks beyond the due date, because they said that due date is a very approximation actually. And this is with all this so-called technology that we have today, subhanAllah. Yeah? The astrology, I'll leave it for another day. It's interrelated. You can go ahead and read ahead, but we'll cover it another time. I think that's enough for today, inshallah. Jazakum Allah khairan. Any questions, any comments, any corrections, any concerns? Yes, brother. Alaykum as-salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Okay. Al-what? Al-bin? Maybe they were saying al-jinn. You saw it in writing? I'm not sure. If there is such a creation, we'd have to see some evidence about it. Sometimes some of these tafsirs of certain verses, they will take from what are called Israeliyat, the Israelite stories, which are stories from the Jewish or the Christian traditions and scriptures and writings and so on. These, they're not always so accurate. So the Prophet ﷺ informed us in general with these kind of narrations, that what we should do is, if it confirms what's in the Quran and Sunnah, we can accept it. If it contradicts and goes against what's in the Quran and Sunnah, we completely reject it. And if it's additional information, we don't know if it's true or not, then we also say, could be true, could be not, we don't know. We leave it like that. Yeah? Because whatever Allah didn't put for us in the Quran and authentic Sunnah, we actually don't need. It's additional information. So sometimes, you know, I'll give a lecture about a prophet, for example, and then the people will ask me, what was his wife's name, and how many children did he have, and what was the name of the city he lived in, and what was his favorite color, and none of that matters, actually. And that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala didn't tell us. He gave us limited information based on lessons we can learn from their life. And this was for Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam during his time, to give him the patience and understand what other prophets went through and how they dealt with it, and also for his companions who were suffering through those difficulties, and for the coming Muslim generations who would also have to go through some similar difficulties and so on. So this is something to keep in mind, that whatever is not in the Quran or authentic Sunnah, it's not necessary. You don't need it, because the Prophet ﷺ said, I left you with two things. If you hold tight to them, you will never be misguided. That's the Quran and the Sunnah. So those have everything that we need to live right and to be good and to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and to succeed in this life and in the hereafter. Yeah, Allah knows best. But I haven't heard about that before, I'm not sure. If you can bring the reference, what book is it in? Is it in like Tafsir ibn Kathir or anything, you know? Mufti Menk mentioned Al-Bin. Then ask him, I'm not sure. I don't know. Mufti Menk, he said Mufti Menk mentioned it. Yeah, ask him then. I think he will have references for whatever he said, inshallah. It's an Israelite narration, yeah. So then we don't know. It could be true, could be not. This is kind of like some additional information. But the argument that scholars who said there were something before humans on earth that caused this mischief is the argument based on the angels saying that, because angels, they cannot know the future. So angels are talking now about the past. That's why they are saying to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and asking, they're curious, why will this, you know, going to happen probably again and so on. Allah knows best, yeah. Alaykum as-salam wa rahmatullah. Can pass the microphone? Maybe you can use the microphone.
I just want to know when a person is a prophet.
Okay. From people that are not Muslim? Okay. The non-Muslim. When it's related to sihr or like physical sickness? Sihr, huh? And possession. Okay. Now, number one, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says there is no disease that He has created except that there is a cure. This is what the Prophet ﷺ informed us. Yeah, every illness has a cure. So physical illnesses, they have physical cures. And spiritual illnesses, they have spiritual cures. Now, there are cures which are good and correct and effective. And there are cures that are not so good. So you can take a medicine for a physical illness and it can cause all kinds of side effects. And sometimes what it causes might be worse than what it cured supposedly. Yeah. So this is where human knowledge is still quite limited. Similarly, in the spiritual illness, there is a right way and a wrong way to cure it. Yeah? Why do the jinn afflict somebody? The scholar said, most of the time, that means the person has a big flaw in their aqidah, in their belief. Yeah? Otherwise, jinn, they cannot. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions that shaitan says, I will go against your servants except those who are mukhlisin. They're pure, they're sincere, they have good intention, they have tawheed. These are the ones I cannot affect them. I cannot. I won't be able to. Yeah? But those that have a big flaw in their iman and in their belief and understanding of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, these are the ones that can be easily affected and afflicted. Now, just like in a physical illness, the best cure is prevention. Too many people come, brother, I'm afflicted. Brother, where were you before you got afflicted? Why didn't you come to a class and learn about Islam before you got afflicted? Why didn't you make your dhikr from the small book, which we mentioned it a million times, everyone should have a copy. Read those dhikr every day, brother. Don't come to me after and say, I don't understand why jinn are hurting me and why I have this one happen to me and my family and so on. So the best cure is prevention. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us clearly, shaitan is your enemy, take him as an enemy. Means defend yourself, guard yourself, protect yourself, attack when necessary. But don't just stand there weak and then say, I don't understand why I got hurt. Doesn't make sense. Yeah? So now, there's a right way and a wrong way. The right way is when you do ruqya, you can, number one, do ruqya on yourself. Yeah? Ruqya can be done for physical or spiritual ailment. What is ruqya? Ruqya is the laying on of hands and curing through the word of Allah and the dua. Yeah? This is it. You put your hand on the place, the Prophet ﷺ would feel pain in his body, physical pain. He will put his hand, he will say, Bismillah, Bismillah, Bismillah. Yeah? He will say, A'udhu bi kalimati Allahi tammati min sharri ma ajidu wa uhadhir, for example. So the Prophet ﷺ would say these different kind of du'as and dhikr. He will read Surah Al-Fatiha, he will read Ayat Al-Kursi, he will read the last three surahs of Quran. The Prophet ﷺ, before he sleeps, he'll blow into his hands, read those three surahs, wipe over his body. Yeah? He will do these kind of things. Now you can do for yourself, but sometimes if a person has a major sihr afflicting him or they have been possessed, it becomes quite difficult to do for themselves. So they need someone to do for them. Yeah? We should not force somebody to beg and ask for that. Yeah? It's better if we can do it for the person, especially if it's our loved one or our family member, before they even ask. Why? The Prophet ﷺ said there are 70,000 people, they will enter paradise without any accounting at all. They will go straight to Jannah. They will not be questioned about a single thing. Those people, they have very strong Tawheed and very strong Tawakkul. One of the things that the Prophet ﷺ mentioned about their characteristics, they never ask anyone to do ruqya for them. So the scholar said, best thing you can do is do ruqya for yourself or have someone hopefully that can do it for you from your family without you asking them or begging them. Yeah. So for me, I will do ruqya on my own children, on my family and so on. There is a ruqya which is a preventative ruqya as well for the young children. Why? Because they don't know how to do their own dhikr to protect themselves. So the Prophet ﷺ would put his hands on his grandsons, Hassan and Hussein, for example, on a regular basis. You should do it every day. And he will say, "U'idukuma bi kalimati Allahi tammati min sharri." No, "U'idukuma bi kalimati Allahi tamma min kulli shaytan wa hamma wa min kulli ayn lamma." So this is asking Allah to protect them from the shaytan, from the ayn, the evil eye, and any kind of harmful things. So now you said we might go to non-Muslim and we find that they bring some results. The results that they bring, as we mentioned, is through using shirk and kufr. It's haram. So you are sinful for going to them and you are compounding the problem. Because now the jinn afflicted you because you have a default in your belief about Allah. Now your belief about Allah got even worse because you are attributing the cure to this person. That's why the true raqi, the true Muslim who does ruqya, when you come to them, the first thing they do is lecture you about tawheed. And then they tell you, you better not for a second believe I'm the one who's going to cure you. I'm not. Only Allah can cure you. And you better believe that firmly, otherwise this will not work. They will talk to you like this. Yeah? And then they will do some recitation on you, and then they will tell you what to continue doing on your own. Why? Because if the jinn is fully possessing a person, or if a person has been afflicted by sihr, it's not just snap of a finger and it's over just like that. It's not that easy. Not that easy. Once they've been given a foothold, they cannot just be taken out easily. They were given the foothold. Why? Because you already had deviated big time. Means you are not practicing Islam properly, you're not having a good belief, so he already got a hold over you. Shaitan already said, he said, I never forced them to do anything, I only invited them and they answered my invitation. And the more you answer his invitation by doing sin and not doing the good, the more control he has over you, till he can even fully possess the person. Yeah. So this is the problem, so to reverse that is difficult. But you can make it very uncomfortable for the jinn when you start praying five times a day on time and you pray in the masjid in jama'ah and you make your dhikr all the time. If the jinn is weak, pretty soon he will run away. He cannot take it. When a raqi reads Quran on a person, the words of Allah burn the jinn, burn him. till he screams. That's why you can even hear the person screaming. It's a different voice. It's not the person's voice, it's the jinn. And he's screaming so painful. So those who also do this, sometimes what they will do, because they may get to the point, if the jinn refuses to leave, they want to kill him. Now, killing the jinn can be difficult because they might kill the person too. Yeah. So to kill the jinn, sometimes they will even tie up fingers and toes and all these things, because these are places of points of entry and exit. So they want to make it impossible for him to exit. Yeah, and they stop him from doing this. You see the headbangers doing this symbol? This is a sign of shaitan. So even the person, when you're reading on him, you'll find him doing that. So they will tie with string his hands down, and he's trying to fight. He wants to get that out. So the person will tell the jinn, get out or I'm going to kill you. So they will read till the jinn will be killed. He will die. And you will see the person, he's reading Quran, and then he will do like this. He will blow on the person. And the person, like he got punched in the face so hard, bah, and screaming. Yeah. So the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is so powerful, the effect that they can have on the jinn. But also the person has to have the right belief. Yeah, the person who is reading also has to have the right belief. And then it can bring a cure. It can be a cure for physical ailment, as I said. And it's also a cure for this kind of spiritual problems. Now you go to the one who's a sahir, and he has already made an agreement with that jinn. Listen, just leave him, because now he's going to start worshipping me, and I'm going to misguide him even further, and I'll make sure he's going to hellfire with all of us, don't worry. Then of course, the jinn will leave immediately. That's the goal, that's what we wanted, great. So you will see a result, but that result will damn you forever. Yeah? And that jinn can leave, and he can come back after a while and bother you again. Doesn't mean he will be gone forever. Especially if that bomo, he wants you to become reliant, dependent upon him. He wants you to keep coming back, because what? He's making money, he's getting prestige, he's saying, look at me, what I can accomplish. All the people start coming to him, and then he will give you silly rituals to do. Take some dirt, go to the grave, do this one, do that one, slaughter some blood, take the blood, wipe it like this, do that. It's all haram things, all shirk. So the person is dooming and damning themselves. Maybe you cured yourself from some ailment you are getting temporarily in this life, but in the hereafter, what's waiting for you if you do it that way? Does that make sense? So this is why we have to be very, very cautious. We can never seek out haram means for this kind of thing. No non-Muslim can help us. Also, no ignorant Muslim who's claiming that they understand Islam and know how to do it can help us. We need to be very, very cautious about the tactics and techniques that are used. Now, some of the techniques used are not explicitly mentioned in Quran and Sunnah, but that kind of came from experience, even from the early days of Sahaba. So some of them would say, we read on water, and then we have the person drink water. Why? Because the power of Allah's words is there, and it can affect the water. The water is drunk, and then it has, you know, an effect inside the body of the person. This one is not explicitly mentioned. Some scholars are very strict. They said if it's not explicitly mentioned, you cannot use it. Others said no. As long as it's using the words of Allah and using proper means, it should be okay. Even some went to the point that they said if you write the words of Allah on paper and you put the paper in the water and the ink goes in there, these words of Allah can have an effect in many ways. So even that will have an effect and they will drink it. SubhanAllah. So these are things like sidr leaves. Sidr is used when we prepare the body in the funeral and all this kind of things. The people who are in this industry, they will use sidr many times. So they put sidr leaves into the water that they will read on, and they tell the person, you bathe with this. Yeah, they will use this sometimes as a cure from Ain, for example, and so on. Yeah? If you're interested about this, there is a small book. I have one copy with me maybe. It's called Ar-Ruqya. It's by the same author of Husnul Muslim. Sheikh Saeed Al-Qahtani. Yeah, he's alive. He's during our time, actually, he prepared these books. So this one is called Ar-Ruqya. So he brings all the different steps and what to say and how to do and so on for different ailments, whether evil eye, whether sihr, whether all this possession, for example, by jinn, different things that you can be aware of. You can also go for Ibn Al-Qayyim's book, Prophetic Medicine. So he has sections about physical cures and ailments, and also about the spiritual ailments and cures. This has been translated into English. You can find it many places. Prophetic Medicine by Ibn al-Qayyim al-Jawzi, rahimahullah. Does that answer your question, brother? This is a very good question, very important point, because sometimes people will say we do see results. But at the same time, I've seen that non-Muslims come and we can do ruqya for them and they can be cured. Yeah. So ruqya, of course, can have an effect only according to how strong is the one who's reading. So for example, the righteous tabi'een, the followers of Sahaba, during their time, they were doing ruqya. They said, subhanAllah, we still have Surah Al-Fatiha, but we don't have Umar ibn al-Khattab. They said, Umar ibn al-Khattab, if he reads on someone, whatever he has, he just reads Fatiha one time, and the person is cured. Boom. Physical or spiritual ailment, cured. It's very fast. So he said, now we come, we read seven times, and we tell them, come again, we'll read tomorrow, and we read for a week, and still we see very small effects. Why? Because the iman is different. So it's a sword. But a sword in a strong hand is different than a sword in a flimsy weak hand. There's a big difference. Yeah. So the words of Allah are powerful, but we who are being cured have to believe firmly that this will cure us, and that Allah is the one who's curing us, and the person who's reading also has to have that belief. You are not doing anything miracle or something. No, this is the words of Allah. The words of Allah are very powerful, subhanAllah. Yeah, may Allah give us knowledge, guidance. May Allah protect us. May Allah make us conscious and aware so that we are always protecting ourselves and so on. Let's see here if there's some. Please help to announce registration of the Iqra class. Okay. We have a class, alhamdulillah, that we started mainly for our new Muslim brothers and sisters, but it's open also for everyone who wants to learn how to read Quran and how to read Arabic in particular. It's starting from a very basic level. How do we recognize the letters in the beginning, middle, and end of the word? How do we know the vowels? How do we pronounce the words correctly, the letters? Now, even those who supposedly know how to read well, they may benefit from this class though, because with all due respect, for many of the different races, they have a very difficult time pronouncing Arabic letters correctly. So this sheikh, it's Sheikh Ibrahim Zaimi, the Albanian sheikh that's come with me a few times before. He's a non-Arab who has now become an expert in Arabic. His Arabic is better than mine. So he has a good ability to help, inshallah, people understand how do we pronounce the letters correctly. It's very important for Quran because a small mispronunciation changes the entire meaning. So you have to recite correctly. Scholars said those that mispronounce Quran on purpose, they are not Muslims anymore. They're out of Islam if you change the words of Quran on purpose. If you do so by accident or because you are unable to pronounce correctly, they said you could be sinful if you're negligent, meaning you didn't put proper effort to learn how to pronounce. Some people cannot pronounce, they cannot pronounce R or L. That's the way Allah created their mouth, they have a speech impediment. But most of us, we don't have that problem. We just need to put a conscious effort to pronounce correctly. So if you haven't done that, the scholar said the person will be sinful. Meaning when you're reading Quran and you say wala dhalin instead of wala dhalin. It's a huge difference. One of them means misguided. The other one means the people under the shade. It's a huge difference in meaning. Totally opposite meanings. Yeah. So we need to be very aware and put in that proper effort. This class will start on February 15th, next Saturday. And it'll be every Saturday for 12 weeks, for 3 months, to get through that entire level, inshallah. For those that continue with the Shaykh and get to the point where they can recite with all of the ahkam of tajweed properly, he will give them an ijazah. He will give them a certificate showing that they have mastered that. If you memorize the Quran and recite that, he can give you a sanad. He can give you a chain of narration back to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam himself. So this Iqra class will begin next Saturday. So registration is, I think the deadline is today. So you can register and pay with Brother Thomas. Brother Thomas is there. So please see him, inshallah, after the class if you're interested. We already have a good number that have registered, alhamdulillah. Did I have another question here? I heard that Ayn can cause harm to us and our children. How do we protect ourselves from this? Ayn can affect us. The Prophet ﷺ said the evil eye is true. It's the truth. It can afflict. It, to the point that a person can even afflict themselves with evil eye. A person can even afflict themselves or their loved ones with evil eye. How do you prevent harming someone with evil eye? What do you say? You say, MashaAllah, or Allah yubarak. May Allah bless that thing. Yeah? So you say that this is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has willed, and may Allah bless. You see a nice car, you see a nice house, you see a beautiful child, you see a... What I was surprised about, Malaysian culture, it seems people don't say that. And the only time I heard them say, MashaAllah, is when something bad happens. So someone died, they're like, MashaAllah. What? For Arabs, they only say MashaAllah for good things. So when it's like, yeah, so-and-so passed away, and the Malaysian was like, mashallah, the Arabs were like, whoa, that's insulting. Why would they say that? They're happy that he died? Yeah? So it's very, maybe, wrong usage of the word. Mashallah literally means whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala willed. But when you get bad news, you're supposed to say what? Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un, actually. Yeah? So mashallah, you say that whenever you see something good or beautiful, even your own self in the mirror, if you think you're beautiful, mashallah. So say, mashallah, may Allah bless, Allah yubarak, or barakallahu feek, or something like this. Yeah? This is how you prevent afflicting someone. And people have it and don't even know sometimes they have it. Yeah? Some scholars believe it comes from a certain kind of jealousy or envy or hatred that a person has, but Allah only knows what causes it exactly. But, you know, as there are sound waves and light waves and all these things in the world, somehow people are able to send this kind of thing that affects others, subhanAllah. So in the Prophet ﷺ's time, a man was bathing, but they were bathing where only partially they're covered. So his upper body was showing and he had perfect skin. So somebody said, wow, look at this skin. What kind of skin is this? The man fell unconscious immediately. So they told the Prophet ﷺ about it. And the Prophet ﷺ said, do you want to kill your brother? When you see something that is good or beautiful, say, mashallah, may Allah bless it. Don't just be jealous and hateful and so on about it. And you mention it in this kind of, you know, like way, like, oh wow, like, because you want to have that. And you maybe even wish that they didn't have it, subhanAllah. Yeah? So this is something very important. How do we protect ourselves from evil eye? Same way we protect ourselves from jinn, from sihr, from all these kind of things. Read, for example, the last surahs of the Quran. قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ الْفَلَقِ قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ النَّاسِ The Prophet ﷺ used to use different du'as until Allah revealed those surahs for him to use as a protection and a prevention, and also as a cure for someone who might have been afflicted. The true cure for Ayn is very precise, actually. So if you know who's evil-eyed you, then that person is supposed to wash over a bucket in a certain way, and that water, a person who's been afflicted is supposed to be washed with it, subhanAllah. Yeah? And this is what the Prophet ﷺ asked to be done during his time. But it can be hard sometimes to get afflicted. To know who's afflicted you. I just talked about my car, which is not a very good car. But I talked about it in front of some people last night, praising how it's lasted me for 5 years. And this morning I got in a car accident. This morning. So I was telling one of the brothers, because he called me and said, oh, I just got in a car accident. And he said, it was you were talking about the car last night. You remember? I said, this car, someone will evil eye it. Subhanallah. Maybe I evil eyed myself. Allah only knows. Yeah. So you cannot always know who did it. To be able to come to them and say, wash in this way, and then give me the water, and so on. Then they will splash it on the person's back. That's what the Prophet ﷺ had done for the man that went into the coma. And then he woke up immediately and he was cured from it, subhanAllah. Yeah? So this is all you can find more about these kind of things in the Prophetic Medicine by Ibn al-Qayyim, rahimahullah. If you're interested about these things, you can read more about it, inshallah. Okay, any other questions? Otherwise, we do have a request here. Yes, brother. Assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Is there any means, any authentic means to perform ruqyah for a person who is not present, far away, or in a home country
somewhere? Some difference of opinion among scholars about this, again, about the techniques. So now some websites, some shuyukh have done a lot of recitations, or they took recitations from some famous a qari like Mashari Rashid al-Afasi or whoever, and they piece it together in a way, and then they have it repeat certain number of times, like Fatiha 7 times, Ayatul Kursi, last 3 surahs, Surah al-Jinn, surahs from Al-Baqarah talking about the magician. You know, they take certain verses that reciters who do ruqyah have found are effective and can harm the jinn and so on, and they made this onto like a CD or a website, and they say, play this and listen to it. And some people found that that has had some good effects, but some scholars are against that. They said this is not a legitimate technique. Should be done through recitation with the hand and on the people and so on. Allah knows best. I'm not really sure about that to give you a fatwa. But yeah, this one where it's done over the phone, for example, or something like that. But there are stories where, for example, in the time of some great scholars, they would come to a person and say, Sheikh, can you come and read on so-and-so? He's been afflicted. He said, listen, I don't have time to come right now. I'm very busy. I'm having lectures and so on. But he said, here's a note. You give it to the jinn and you threaten him that I will come if he doesn't leave. And you take my slippers to prove to him that it's from me. So they would take it and the jinn, he flees. Because he's afraid that that guy will really come and read, yeah? Otherwise, you know, he will regret it. If those kind of, you know, certain righteous people that are very close to Allah, they will have obviously a more powerful effect. So also the jinn will be more terrified from them. Somebody like Umar ibn al-Khattab, the Prophet ﷺ said, if shaitan sees him walking down a path, he will run in the opposite direction. Can you imagine? Shaitan himself will run away. He doesn't even want to be on the same street with Umar ibn al-Khattab because of how strong he is and so on, yeah? In his iman. And physically strong also, actually. Yeah.
One more thing.
Okay.
I hear that if someone asks for wudu water,
okay,
because Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said that if your brother asks for wudu water, then give it to him.
What do you mean? Water for him to make wudu, or the wudu that comes off of you after you made wudu, like the leftover?
Evil eye. To give that leftover wudu water for him to make
flour. I'm not sure. I never heard of that. But this is what I told you is the official cure for evil eye, is to use the water from the person that washes. But they don't make wudu. They actually even wash part of their clothes. In one narration, they wash even their private parts. There's a specific way that they have to wash, actually. It's not wudu. But that water, does a person, should they never refuse, they have to give it over? I'm not sure. I never read that. But could be, because I was wondering about that. I mean, it could be difficult to approach someone and say, listen, brother, I think you evil-eyed me. So give me this water and so on. They may say, you know, be offended. What do you mean I evil-eyed you? How come? And so on. But they should not. I mean, this is part of Islam, part of the Sunnah, that the Prophet ﷺ told the man who did afflict. And how did they know? Because he said those words, then immediately there was an effect. Yeah? Now, where is the power and the will of Allah in all of this? Of course, if Allah wills, that person cannot be affected. So many people who have evil eye may be envious of certain people, and those people have never been afflicted by it. Allah is protecting them. They're protected by their making dhikr and so on. When I got in that car accident, my wife reminded us, because we had just started out, we didn't read dua al-rukub. We didn't read it yet. Yeah, we started chatting about something right away, and then the accident happened. Had we read it, probably Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala could have protected us, and we wouldn't have been in that accident, subhanAllah. So the scholars have mentioned, even those who say dhikr all the time, if Allah wants something to happen to you, that day you'll forget to say it. And that's what's happened to me. Anytime I've been in a car accident, it means I some reason was rushing, and I hadn't read dua al-rukub yet, and I got in the accident before it. Otherwise, we believe wholeheartedly that those things protect us. And you have to have a strong faith and yaqeen that those things will protect you. The only time you can get afflicted then, if you're always doing them, is that you don't do it. You somehow get busy, Allah makes you forget it, subhanAllah, and whatever Allah decrees is going to happen to you in the end. But Allah may have also saved you from millions of different occurrences, and you will know about that on the Day of Judgment. Yeah? Wa iyyakum. Any other questions, comments from our sisters? We didn't get anything from the ladies. Maybe the written ones were from the sisters. Any questions? Okay, yes, can pass the microphone. That's right. Jazakallah khair. That's right. So I will just say it now, I don't do it for anyone. I will not do it. So the brother said, if you do ruqya on people that are possessed by jinn or sihr or these kind of things, you yourself have to be strong. Because the jinn will try to retaliate. So my sheikh, for example, that would help a lot of people with this, they attempted to kill him a few times. Yeah, they attempted to kill him a few times, but they were not able to. They also will go after your family. If you are well protected, then they try to go after your wife, children, others that are not maybe making the dhikr as much or not as well protected and try to harm them. So some scholars even mention that the one who does this kind of professionally, better if they're a bachelor and they don't have any wife and children in their life. They have to be someone who's very strong in their knowledge, in their connection with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They have to be very regular in their dhikr, not committing any kinds of major sins at all, so on and so forth. So you have to be a certain type of person to do it, actually. So I'm not that person, so I don't do it for others. Yeah, I would only do it for myself or my immediate family maybe. That's it. Yeah. Jazakallah khair. But always again, prevention is the best cure. So we protect ourselves, we never have to worry about this. We have a proper understanding of Tawheed, we don't have to worry. Allah will never allow something like this to harm us. Yeah? The jinn in actuality are very weak creatures. You just say, A'udhu billahi min shaytanir rajim, immediately he has to pull back, he cannot harm you anymore. The Prophet ﷺ said, if he continues to bother you, maybe you didn't say your A'udhu billahi min shaytanir rajim very sincerely, what do you do over your left shoulder in salah? Or even if you wake up from a nightmare from shaitan in the middle of the night, what do? You just blow three times over your shoulder, and he's immediately, as if you shot him with a machine gun or you punch him in his face, he's so weak. And it's something amazing, subhanAllah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave the believer this kind of power by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we have to have that kind of strength and confidence in our iman. Shaitan cannot and will not harm us bi-idhnihi ta'ala, yeah? By the will and the permission of Allah. Anything else? Okay. Jazakumullah khairan. We have one announcement here that someone has said, my auntie has just passed away, would appreciate a short dua at the end of this lecture. Her name is Che Emma. Am I pronouncing it correctly? C-H-E-A-M-A-H. Che Emma. Che Emma. Okay. Sheikh Tad'u. هذه أخي تقول أن عمتها وخالتها توفت فتطلب دعاء من الجميع يعني شخص يدعو ونحن نؤمن ما رأيك أنت تقول الدعاء نعم دعاء للميت يعني وأيضا عامة للمسلمين ولل ما رأيك فعل أنت لا لا يلا بسم الله لأن أنا بالعربي سيكون ضعيف يلا شيخ ادعو أنت. This is our Sheikh who will be teaching the Iqra class. So his Arabic is also better than mine. So I ask him, he will lead the dua and we will all say Ameen, inshallah. توفيت الآن قبل لحظات يعني فكتبوا هذا فقالوا ممكن ندعو لها. الشيخ حسين عادة يفعل هذا الشيء. إذا أحد الجماعة وأحد الأقرباء يعني يموتون فيطلبون من الجميع الدعاء هكذا مع بعض.
Yeah.
Jazakallah khairan. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have mercy on Sister Che Amma, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make her steadfast when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is having her questioned, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make her grave a garden from the gardens of paradise. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make it easy on her family and give them patience and perseverance. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us all the best end, an excellent end that leads to Jannat al-Firdaus. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to reunite us with all of our loved ones, those that have passed away and those that will pass away, in Jannat al-Firdaus, where we can be together in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's glory and pleasure. Jazakum Allah khairan. Subhanakallahumma wa bihamdik. Ashhadu an la ilaha illa ant. Astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk. Walhamdulillah wa salatu wa salamu ala rasulillah. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.